If I ever took a loss, I learned a lesson. I won't ever think I'm better than the next man. I've been down before to come up on these stresses. Baby, I'm too busy counting all these blessings.
KB Smooth, Trucker 78. Call me Smooth. Call me KB. Call me a lot of things. But one thing you can't call me is scared. I'm gonna say I don't get scared. I just say I don't fear the end result of this game called life. Nor we'll get into that in a minute. We'll get into that. But anyway, y'all know how I get down. First and foremost, glory to God, G2G. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Father, for waking us up. Thank you, Lord. Waking me and everybody that's up and that just out here trying to live, trying to do right by you, Lord. We thank you, Lord. We thank you so much, Lord. Father, help me to reveal to these people that dare to watch this video to the truth, the inner truth, and what's been going on my mind, my spirit, and soul that have been weighing on me to get out, to help, hopefully help somebody that hears or that dares to watch this video to his end, Lord, that they can know that they can endure anything in this world, Lord. Keep us safe. Keep us whole. Help those that don't believe in you, Lord, that reveal something in their life that they will know that you are God, you know. But that's their choice, Lord. You gave us free will of choice. I just thank you, Father, for all things, Lord. Lord, I love you. I praise you and I thank you. All in his name. Amen. What's going on? I know I'm going to lose views off of that. I don't care. This is a different type of video, y'all. I know y'all used to KB. Yeah, you know, smiling. Don't get, I'm internally happy. I just got some things on my mind, y'all. A lot of stuff been rubbing me the wrong way. And a disclaimer, y'all that dare to watch this video, I'm not gonna go for an hour, but I'm gonna go in at least. I'm gonna give y'all at least 15 to 20 on this. So I'm gonna tell you right now, you might want to tune out if you ain't ready to feel the truth, ready to feel the raw emotions of this brother named KB. I'm gonna say my full government, Kevin Brown on this video right here. All right, so. Yeah, I'm still in Wisconsin. It's frigid temperatures out here, by the way. So I'm at this mom and pop truck stop off of I-94. If y'all are ever up this way, I-94, flatbed gang, you see that right there. It's a nice spot. I mean, it's got a nice restaurant. I gave this thing 5 stars. I mean, the only con is this dirt lot that they try to put asphalt on, but our heavy trucks, it's some potholes. You got to be careful, especially at night. But it's plenty of parking. You got this whole lot, and it's parking over there by the Hardee's and the hotel. So, but yeah, that's why I chilled at today. Headed down south, y'all. Y'all know y'all there. Thank y'all for that support, brother. Y'all watched my video I put up yesterday. Thank y'all. Team Fit Crew. But this video is inspired by a lot of things. First and foremost, inspired by my man upstairs. A lot of stuff just ain't been sitting right with me, but I've been kind of letting it go. I've been out here I lost focus on the prize a little bit and started focusing on the worldly things, this trucking-ish. Started losing focus, started letting my health go again. Yeah, I take responsibility, and that's another thing, y'all. We need to start taking responsibility for our actions out here, man. But yeah, it declined. I got sick again. But I'm gonna talk about another sickness. It's a sickness that we. I'm gonna put this out here right here. Walk by faith, not by sight. See these eyes? I just had a vision test a few months ago, and doctor says I had damn near perfect vision. I've been shot, y'all. See this eye? See? I don't know if y'all can see that. It'll heal. This over 11, 12. That wound is about 11, 12 years old now. But I shouldn't be had that right. I'm blessed to talk to y'all anyway, but I shouldn't have no eye. I shouldn't be able to see. I can almost see better out this eye than my eye that never got shot. I still have scrap note. This is all reconstructed, y'all. This is a little story on KB. Yep. I served in the military 10 and a half years, staff sergeant. Gun ho, third ID. Rock of tomorrow, baby. Army strong, baby. We are one. The unity and the camaraderie in the military is untouched, for the most part. Don't get me wrong. It's still conflict in there. But it's more, I miss that so much. I thought out here, especially this trucking game, but this in life, man. It's sad, so sad how people, there's no, it's like the love is gone. The humanity is gone out of people. They're turning into raw savages. We are God's greatest creation. We rule this earth. We have dominion over the beasts, the animals. But people are turning into what we rule over. I'm just getting real with you. I'm going to break it out. Biblical stuff coming. That's why I say y'all might want to turn it. KB, y'all ain't going to like KB after this, but I could give two whats, man. All I, that, why was that man upstairs happy with this man he see? We good, man. So, shout out to, I got a special shout out. There's a brother from another mother of mine. I met through this social media. Actually, Zello app. We got, and y'all still my family, by the way, Stu. But, yeah, name, he goes by the name of Attitude, spell A-T-T with a 2-D, he got a YouTube channel, Trucking with Attitude. We had a good long talk conversation yesterday, which I was much needed, man. Brother was down, he's down speed, but I was driving, I was back out here, you know, working. And he inspired me to tell y'all some things, to open up, to let y'all know a little things about KB. So I won't say it, I might get a little emotional. Then, as I'm waking up this morning, getting my spiritual pre-trip in. Yeah, I got three pre-trips I do. From the wake up, spiritual, I'm on prayer as soon as I get up, thanking him. Then I do my personal pre-trip, which is my hygiene. I just went in there, brushed my teeth, washed my face. I took a shower last night, so I'm clean on that. So just touching up on things. Then of course you got the, you know, this pre-trip here, truck, you know, before I get to leave. But I got time on this load. Yeah, I just got out my sleeper berth, so I'm on DOT. Yeah, so I'm a ride today because I got all day. I got till Monday to get to where I'm going to Florida. So I'm at 10 hours and 45 minutes, but I'll roll out about 12. You know, right now I'm gonna do this video because it's more important to me to get this off my chest. So shout out to you, TWA. And then this morning I catch another video from my sis, keeping it 100. If y'all ain't subscribed to Pinky. And don't go over there for the savage beast and the lust for her. She got a husband now, or what she will. She got a man. She living her life. She ain't fooling with nobody. She is a really inspiration. She is a, you want to talk about motivational? I think she should be putting up there with Denzel Washington motivational speeches. I think she posted something on YouTube where they actually classifying her videos as motivation. So she is a blessing. She is a wonderful spirit. Love you, sis. Pinky. Y'all go sub to her. Don't look at her for her looks. Look at her for what she's saying. Listen to her. She is a beautiful woman, but she's clean. She broke some stuff down to me this morning that I lost sight of, which is letting situations, letting the world, the regime, cloud your mind to think and act like them to what you want to be successful or chase money, chase, like we chasing out here, money, miles, whatever. Lost sight of the focus, which is living my best life, serving the Lord, the money's going to come. And yeah, all this, you know, I'm on operator. I'm a lease operator. Been leasing for 5 months now. Yeah, going on 5 months. Yeah, with June, July, August, September, October, November. Yeah, the end of this month. Yeah, so it's been a rough ride, y'all. It's been a rough ride. I done went weeks without a paycheck. Why? Y'all know y'all can say, oh, he don't know what he's doing and none of that. Nah. Well, I say I don't know what I'm doing. Didn't know what I'm doing. I didn't read the fine print. Dart, just like every company. And don't get me wrong, I'm not bashing Dart, but they funny with the money. They funny with the numbers. But I'm in it to win it. Now, I claim that this is my truck. She spoke on things, what I just said. Claiming. We can speak sickness out, we can speak on stuff, and we can claim it right then and there. We start allowing the world and the judgment and the society, and social media too. Social media to kill the human interaction too, man. I'm losing my voice a little bit, so bear with me. give me one second. Guilty 718. Got to give him something. Look, bullpen gang. This is guilty. Guilty, yeah, bullpen gang. But I never been a gangster. People take that word gang too for... I know I'm bouncing around here, but I got a lot of stuff going on upstairs. Don't you know gang really started with unity? You read your Bible, Old Testament. There's gangs from day one. You know, tribes. They called them tribes back then. Then they changed to clans, cults, stuff. But they tend to take this word like you're a gangster, like you're out here killing people, raping people, selling dope. You know the word gang, Crip, Trey 9, MX-13, Blood, whatever other gangs out there. But we throw this word around a lot, you know, especially out here in trucking, driving, gang, flatbed gang, 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 gang. They even call my family Stoop Gang, but it's a Stoop. But gang... If you look inside of a gang, what does a gang do? They work as a unit. They help one another. One fall, the other one pick one out. So, you can say I'm in a gang. I'm in the human gang of love and compassion and helping one another. Brothers building brothers. Not taking nothing from Al's milk, but I'm saying I'm helping one another, encourage. Sisters build sisters. We all here together. One body of Christ. Yeah, I say to Christ. So... You notice how people won't help one another. People won't even speak. They won't even hold a door for you. You speak, you say, hey, good morning. They walk past you. You see a disabled vehicle. I'm talking about regular POV, not even trucks. You won't help nobody. They struggling. Car fell down with that scissor jack. They can't get the jack on. Now they got to wait for in the dark. Roadside, road ready, State Farm, whoever comes out there to get them. Your own family ain't family no more. They turn against you. Grew up together in blood, but then you fall apart in word. You can't call up your brother and sister and say, hey sis, you know, I need help. Hey bro. I can tell you my family don't abandon me, man. I'm the oldest one of my siblings. All I ever wanted to do to be an example to them. That's why I joined the military. You know, my grandma raised me. Yeah. Oh yeah, by the way, I was raised by a female woman. I dare you say that B word. Dare somebody call, but I'm raised by a strong black Native American / African American, my grandma, Mary Constance Walker. Rest in eternal peace. Bishop, I'm gonna see you that sweet day. Yeah, I ain't afraid to cry. Grown men cry. Anyway, so 10th grade, she passed. I'm in high school playing football. I gotta get a job now. I gotta help raise, support my brothers and sisters. I'm walking to work. My first job was, yep, KFC, Kentucky Fried Chicken. I walked from my house, Fall Hill, used to be called Bragg Hill, then Fredericksburg, Virginia, all the way up Route 1 to Route 3. By, say, overall about 5.5 miles, round trip about 12 miles. Every day, did my school work. It was hard. I almost dropped out. I almost didn't graduate, but I got my diploma because I promised my mom in heaven that I'll be the first grandkid to graduate. And I was one of the first. And y'all family that's watching, I'm not knocking nobody that ain't get their degree. We all had different paths. But I was proud to say that I got that diploma. Then it was life. I was in the streets. I was doing bad stuff. Dope game. Whatever, whatever. Robbing. Doing whatever. Saw a guy shot right in front of my house, 334 Brock. Dead right there on the sidewalk. Then my mom, shout out to my flesh and mom, my earth mom. That we rekindled all that shit with them. She took my brothers and sisters back. Then it was just me, my aunt, my cousin Mike, my uncle and stuff. And yeah, it just got so crazy, man, that I had to leave, man. And I said, what can I do? I don't have the money to go to college. I was good at football, but I didn't get scholarship for my area. We was a AA, you know, small little school, little town, you know. So, recruiter, I did good. I was smoking weed. I'll tell you, yeah, your boy used to smoke weed. I took the ASVAB to get out of you took the ASVAB, you had the rest of the day off. So I took the ASVAB, was the Armed Force battery test. Scored high as a mug on there. Almost enough to fly a damn astronaut plane. But my weight, I really wanted to join the Air Force. I wanted to fly jets, but that wasn't God's plan. So they kept recruiters calling me, Marines, of course, Army, Navy, Air Force. Air Force turned me down because of my weight. I couldn't fit in the cockpit. They wanted me, I could have been a medic or a chow hall, or I could have been a helicopter pilot, but I didn't. I wanted to fly the jets, the Tomcat at the time. F-14, the F-16 back in my day, the 90s. So that didn't work, but the recruiter for the Army was a good friend of the family, Staff Sergeant Barkley. He took me and my cousin Mike out to dinner. He used to come out check on us all the time. We played basketball hoops with him. It got to the point where I got so sad, so depressed that I didn't know what to do in life. I didn't want to feel like I was a failure. I didn't want to let my brothers and sisters down. I didn't want to let my mom in heaven down that risked her life to raise three generations of kids. So I got to the point where I put that blunt down. I called a recruiter. I said, man, what do I got to do to join the Army? He said, you really want to do? So this man came by and PT'd me for 45 days, which is physical training. I ran up and down Fall Hill. I lost 60-something pounds. And then next thing you know, 45 days later, I'm in Richmond MEPS. I'm swearing in. I passed my physical. I'm gone. Fort Benning, Georgia, AIT. No, I'm sorry, basic training, my bad. And that started the military career. After that, I went from Fort Benning, Georgia to Action Jackson, South Carolina, AIT, because I was a 63 Sierra. That is a heavy wheel vehicle mechanic. Y'all that are military, MOS, mission oriented specialist. That's what they call your job title in the military. And let alone, I'm already away from home, and I never left Virginia hardly. Grandma used to take us up to Baltimore to see my aunts. I had a couple aunts live in Baltimore. Had one live in Jacksonville, but never got that far. We used to take the Greyhound. When Greyhound was good, remember Trailways, the Golden Eagle bus? We used Trailways. It was Trailways, the red and white buses, and Greyhound. That's about as far as I went before I joined the Army. My uncle served, Russell Brown, shout out. He served in the Army. He kind of inspired me. Granddad served, you know. My Uncle Willie served. So I figured I'd go in the Army. Follow that path, right? I get picked out of AIT to go overseas. I try to stall it out by taking Hotel A. That's the recovery school after I was a mechanic. So I did two MOSs. I went from, you know, getting the skills to learn how to work on diesels in the Army. Then I Hotel A to recovery, which is a record. You learn how to pull them out the mire pit, pulley system, all that good stuff. So they give me orders to go to Korea. Seoul, Korea, then over there, I went to the DMC up north, Camp Casey. So I fly out to Washington State, Seattle. But that's the way you leave out to go to Korea from the West Coast. Start seeing people I never seen, talking to people. I'm scared private. I got my Class A's on, all green, no rank. That's how you used to have to travel in the military back in the day. Class A with the little green hat. Y'all know the little sail hat called the green hat. So I'm over in Seattle. I've seen the Space Needle. I'm sitting at the USSO in the airport, the USO. That's where the military soldiers go to wait. It was seven of us. One dude, he went AWOL before we went. He got scared, didn't even get on the plane. But so five of us. So seven of us went to Seattle. Five of us got on the plane. They said we'd get on the plane. Something happened to the plane. We had to lay over in Hawaii. I got to see Hawaii, the beautiful island, beautiful woman, beautiful people. The water blue. You can see the fish swimming in the water. Expensive as hell. Walk into McDonald's in Hawaii. Back then, I was eating, you know, whatever. McDonald's, you go here, they had to supersize all that. It costs you, over here, maybe $5, $6 for a meal combo there. Down there, the cost of living so high, it was $15 to get a Big Mac meal, regular size with a Coke. I know y'all be like, damn, and this is in 95, y'all. So, laid over down there for 3 days, chilled, you know, did our thing. Then we had to go back. The plane took us over. So, basically, it took us close to, I say 2 to 2.5 days. But, you know, it's a day behind over there. You get to Korea, damn near a day behind. So, I had to get used to all that. Anyway, so, skip forward. Military service, blah, blah, blah. 10 years later, survived. Two tours overseas. Oops. And, Air to America. So, struggled a little bit when I got the Army. Ended up getting a divorce from the lady I was with in there. That's another story. She hurt my heart though. She ripped my heart out. I had a certain type of way I felt towards women after that. But I'm better now. So speed up to now. Like, I did job after job. I came home, I think my first job out of the Army was working at Hampton Roads Bus Transit, because I used my diesel. Then it was Wilson Trucking Company. I was the trailer guy. I was the one climbing up, fixing the lights. It's funny how all this path led to trucking, by the way. I used to get up, fix the lights. And I had my CDL out of the Army. Back then, you can use your DD-214 and your military license. And you, all you had to do, go down there and take the test. You had to do no training, no over the road, none of that like you do now. And I had a CDL. I gave it up because I went through some depression, drinking again, smoking, gained weight, all that stuff. But anyway, but back to, I worked at, like I said, I worked at Hampton Roads Bus Transit, worked on diesel motors on the buses. Then I worked for Wilson Trucking, trailer guy. So two jobs already. Then they laid me off on Hampton Roads. So then I worked for Caterpillar down there, building cats, old cat motors inside the factory. They had a layoff. So like I said, then I lost my CDL, lost my tools. Yeah, I had about 100. Close to 100 grand in tools. Y'all said, damn, 100 grand? Yeah, tools are expensive. You make an account, you get credit from Snap-on, Mac, Cornwell, all those guys. And, yeah, so go home. End up being homeless down in Norfolk, Virginia. Norfolk, Little Creek Road. I was working a pizza delivery. I worked at, then I started auto mechanics because I had some tools in reserve. So I started auto mechanics. So I worked for, Kim Knock Ford down there. Then I worked at a Honda dealership, Perry Buick. Still smoking weed, still doing, not focused on life. I was a state inspector then now, so I could inspect cars, but I lost all that, man. I just wasn't focused, man. So ended up being homeless, living out my little 91 Eagle Talon Turbo. All I had was a basket in the back. I used to go get the handouts from church, wash up in, that's why I know, like, truckers feeding the homeless really tough, because I've been homeless. But I ain't been laying on the sidewalk homeless, but I've been laying at, being in a car without a legal address. I had no legal tenant, no home. I was no home. So me and my boy Howie, I don't know if you're still on earth, man, but this boy, little Puerto Rican guy, man, stocky guy from New York, man. He from the Five Barrels, y'all. Shout out to Rolex Travels, Choice Mass, or anyway, and Guilty, all y'all New Yorkers. But he was up there from the Bronx, South Bronx. I forgot, over there, you know, Hell's Kitchen. His dad abandoned him. So we out here surviving in the streets like animals. We had to turn into savages. Every night people roll up on us, try to rob us, try to take the little shit we had. So yeah, we had to survive like we, he's ex-military too, by the way. So we survived like an other side, and I ain't gonna get into all that because I don't want y'all to look at me no type of way, but this is the true cave, the molding of this guy you looking in front of me. So yeah, I had to do some stuff that I don't, you know, ain't proud of, but I ain't ashamed of though, because it helped and build the man you looking at today. You know, so we survived eating MREs, eating scraps. Yep, I ate out the, not out the dumpster, but, you know, restaurants shut down. I said, hey, man, before you, like, KFC or pizza places or dough stuff in the back, I said, hey, before you throw that away, can we have it? And they give it to us, you know. So then get out there. Then he ended up getting stabbed one night. I had to take him to Sotera General Hospital. And then, yeah, so then it was just me, Solo Dolo, Kevin Brown, out here in my town. I got kicked out of these, there's a white, my white friend, he was young, I was teaching him how to be a mechanic. We had like a little street outlaw where we build cars and we race. I don't know if y'all remember Drag VA 64, Virginia, that was us. We built little Hondas, racers, and we raced down there. One night we shut the whole tunnels down, had the road bridge tunnel and 664 tunnel down, and we raced all night. They had state troopers say, go look it up. You think I'm lying? Google it. Google the night that y'all had about 100 street racing cars, Hondas, Civics, whatever. That was me. I was a part of that. I had a 2000 SI B16, Gen Spec, Mugen motor, straight from Japan. Did some Skunk 2 headers on her, VTEC controller, lowered. She had stage 2 cams, redid the Gates timing belt. Anyway, she had the works on her. I didn't spray knives on her. She wasn't turboed. I wanted the turbo, but it had 4-to-1 headers, nice coilover kit. Real coilover, not just springs and cut. She was nice, man. VTEC. Y'all know, if y'all know what VTEC is, look it up. Yeah, basically like, oh shit, VTEC kicked in, yo. Yeah, that motherfucker would run, man. So anyway, almost died one night coming out. The police checked me. I was high drunk. I came off the exit drifting in the front wheel drive. You can drift in front wheel drive right there. I drifted that bitch, come out the exit almost 120. Boom. Drop the car. parked it in some neighborhood, started walking down the street because they were looking for all kind of race style cars. The police brought up on me, looked at me, said, "Hey, sir, what are you doing?" I said, I was coming from such and such house. I live up the block, which is cool, because I didn't even know where I was at. I was like only a couple blocks from where my apartment was, which is funny. So once he looked at my ID, he agreed. He said, "Oh, okay." So he said, "Well, we looking for street racing. You sure you don't have a car?" Because he said, "Well, you look like you registered that you have a 2000 Honda registered." Oh, I said my wife had it at the time. My wife, and they believed it. So basically, by the grace of God, I didn't go to jail that night. So I came back to the car the next day. It was still there. Nobody even touched it. None. The white people, he was out there mowing his grass, you know. He was like, "Hey, that's your car?" I said, "Yeah, man, it broke down last night." So I pulled out some fake jumper cables and act like I was getting a jump like it broke down. Started up. He said, "Man, that's a nice sounding car." He is old head. He like V8s and stuff. But he said, "This little sucker sound like it's me." And I said, "Yeah, she got some power." So I creeped on out and go to work. Go home, get changed, go to work. Sorry about that. So long story short, I get to work. Well, on the way to work, getting on the highway, headed down to Virginia Beach. That's where I worked at. And the cops pulled me over. They ran my tags and they said, "Hey, where was you last night? We got a report of a car just like yours eluding police, and we got a all points bulletin. No, Bolo, be on the lookout for a black Honda Civic, Lord, you know." So I was like, "No, sir, it wasn't me. I was at home." And he looked up the officer that stopped me as I was walking down the street. He said, "Oh, yeah, okay. Well, you sure this wasn't the car?" I said, "No, sir." So they couldn't prove it. So basically, he's like, "Well, I got to give you," he gave me an improper exhaust ticket, altered suspension. And I had that mirror tint where it's silver. You know, that mirror tint, he gave me, he put the little thing on there, gave me a ticket for that. So I threw them in the back and worked, but I went to work. So anyway, how long is it? Damn, 26 minutes. So anyway, long story short, man, lost all that stuff, come home, like I said, and this is all surviving all this from the military. Then now I'm in Little Creek Road, working at the pizza shop. A boo rolled up on me, he's like, "Hey, man, you got a cigarette?" I said, "Okay." Yeah, I was smoking Newports then. I said, "Hey, I gave that cat, because that's a friendly." Y'all that true know me and met me, KB, I'll get a shout out my man back to you. But I gave him the man like half my pack of cigarettes. But I didn't realize what he was doing. If I was in my right mind, he was peeping me out. He looked all in my car. Oh, this is what I had. I forgot. I had an 89 two-bubble-eye BMW 325 with the straight 2.7 lean over motor. Yeah, that bitch would run too. So I was sitting in there, man. I was just got off work, you know, tired. So he left. Then he rolled back up with some, I don't know, remember what it was. It was an old body Buick. It was one of those old cars. They used to call them hoopties, but the big boats. Him, four other guys rolled. He said, "Get out the car." I'm going to say the N-word. "Get out the car, nigga." I'm in shock, y'all. I'm like, what's going on? I didn't realize this motherfucker's trying to rob me. So long story short, I gave that man everything he asked for, everything I had. I had $26 in tips, my cigarettes, my cell phone, everything. So he said, "Man, I know you got some more than that. I know you." I said, "Dude, I have enough of you. What the fuck do you want from me?" So he was like, "All right, man." And his partner's like, shoot that motherfucker. I was like, "Man, what do y'all want?" And he was like, "Man, I ain't gonna pop your ass tonight, man, but you lucky." So he get in the car the whole time, staring him down, because I don't know what the fuck is what he gonna do until this motherfucker leave and I can start my car and get the hell out of here. So they pull up, then they back up fast. I said, right in my mind, clicked in military mode. These motherfuckers gonna try to do something. So I was gonna jump out the car, but he jumped out so fast with a 38. He said, "Get out the car, big boy." I said, "What?" I said, "Get out the car, N-word." I said, "All right." I jump out the car. He said, "Get your ass on the ground." I already knew right then he's gonna take my life. I said, "No." I look him dead in the face. 38 right here, y'all. I said, "You gonna take my life, motherfucker. Take it right here. I'm not getting on the ground for you shooting me in the back of my head like a bitch, because you ain't man enough to see the life go out of my eyes in front of your face." He said, "Oh, you going hard, huh? You think I won't do it?" The motherfucker shaking like a hooker in church. I'm studying the gun. I'm training to disable this motherfucker. All of a sudden, it was raining too. A light mist of rain, by the way, ground wet. We got into it, and, you know, shout out to my man 1034, but I know some shit too. He came, I grabbed the gun. I did say, you know, the military. I got it down, boom, boom, boom. I slipped, though. It was wet. I slipped. Looked up, Paya, Paya, yeah, two shots. Seven days later, I woke up in the hospital, Chesapeake General Hospital. Ran by Sentara. Doctor said, "Who are you? Do you know your name?" I said, "Yes, my name is Kevin Lamont Brown." He said, you know, my social, all that. So, all I know is it's blur. I seen the white light, you know. A lot of people say, oh, you know, the after death experience is the white. I died. They brought me back twice. I'll get into that spiritual part on another video. All I remember is he was asking my name and all that, blah, 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 blah. A good Samaritan see me bleeding out on that ground. Came up. Called the 911. Got me to the hospital. I'm here today because of that man. I still don't even know who this person is. If you happen to come across my video, sir, thank you. One for you, God working through you to keep me here because there's still work to be done for Kevin. I wouldn't be here, y'all. So, like I said, I ain't gonna go into it. It's already 30 minutes, y'all. What I'm gonna say, y'all, don't let this world get you down, man. We all out here trying to make a living. We're blessed to be truck drivers. We wake up every day. We go up and down these roads, whether you drive in, flatbed, whatever you do out in trucking, whatever division you are. Focus on yourself. Focus on your inner person. We all change. Life is about change and more change. Change for the better. Wake up every day grateful. Be grateful for life first. Grateful that you got eyes, ears, four arms. Your body may be beat up, but you're moving. Then, just help somebody. I challenge everybody. This is the KB challenge. To help one person a day. Meaning, somebody you see in need, just help them. And I'm not going to hashtag YouTube like the D-Rod challenge, the Eat Challenge, all that bullshit. No. I challenge you off my video, my views, my 500, almost 600 people I got that watch my videos and the 100 that actually do watch. I challenge y'all to help your fellow brother, sister. Just one a day. One a day. That's all I'm asking is one. You ain't got to tell me about it. Just keep that between you and your creator, your God, whoever, whatever you believe in. Let's make this world a better place, man. Starting with us, man. Stop acting a fool, you know. I'm going to speak on this real quick. That Popeye chicken bullshit, that's part of propaganda. That's part of the bamboozlement of the brainwashing of America. You know, people lose their mind over greasy fried chicken that's going to give them heart attack if they keep eating that shit. You can go home and make it yourself. You can go to McDonald's, Chick-fil-A. You can go to any other place, get a regular-ass chicken sandwich. There's nothing special about it. By the way, they're never out of chicken. They say they run out because they want y'all supplying the band. They want you to lose your mind to act like y'all been acting out here, killing motherfuckers over. Yeah, there's a dude got killed over it. There was a video somebody said, I'm tired of seeing the video. I don't even watch it no more. A white man called everybody N-word and walked outside and they beat the brakes off his ass. A girl snatched a girl over the counter, beat her to bloody pulp. She's in jail, by the way. And on it, y'all see it, just look it up. Y'all see it, it's flooding y'all YouTube and y'all social media too. Popeye's chicken craze. You know, it's two pickles.